Christians celebrate the revelation of God as Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This college bears the name of God, the Holy Trinity. And so for us at the college, Trinity Sunday is a day of special significance. The Christian worship of God as Trinity reflects belief in God as a community of persons. And so it is fitting that on Trinity Sunday, we in this college celebrate the life of our own community. And it is fitting as well that we celebrate the special position of Susan Lemon in this community, along with the remarkable contributions she has made to serve the community of her native Singapore and elsewhere as a medical pioneer, a surgeon, and a researcher of international distinction. A fellowship at the college is the highest honor Trinity can bestow, and yet no one who reads the biographical sketch of Susan on the back of the Order of Service book could miss the fact that the right of honoring in this case goes two ways. Susan Lemon honors her college in accepting this fellowship to honor her. Trinity College has, since its early days, been closely connected with medical education and medical research in Melbourne. Innumerable Trinity students since the 1870s have studied medicine, and in the process, the college has helped to shape many of those who have gone on to assume leadership positions in the medical profession, including several deans of medicine in this very university, and one of those deans is Professor Richard Markins, now Vice Chancellor of Monash University, Susan's alma mater. And Richard, like Susan, a fellow of Trinity College, he will deliver the chief address later in the service. It's a great pleasure to welcome Richard and Caroline Markins back to the college they know so well and which they have supported so generously. Although Trinity is a college of the University of Melbourne, in 1977 they then were the late Reverend Dr. Evan Burge recognized the young Monash student, Susan Lim, an individual of outstanding quality and character, and promptly and wisely admitted her to Trinity as a resident. Thank God for that. Trinity College has deep links with Monash University, which go back to the service of Warden Cowan, who was on the inaugural council that brought Monash into being. Moreover, two of Monash's earliest professors, Kevin Westfold and Agnes Shaw, were Trinity alumni who later became fellows of the college. I'm delighted that Professor and Mrs. Shaw are here with us tonight, along with Warden Burge's spouse, Barbara, and Warden Cowan's son, Bill. Given all these, as it were, familial connections, we're obviously delighted that Trinity's contributions to cooperation between the two universities is again vividly reflected in tonight's service. Susan Lim came into residence at Trinity in 1977, just 3 years after the college had become fully co-residential. Yet Trinity has, in fact, had a long and proud history of pioneering educational opportunities for women, including the creation in 1886 of a women's section of the college, which a few decades later became our neighbor, Janet Clark Hall. Interestingly, the first woman admitted as a non-resident student of Trinity in 1883, Lillian Alexander, was later also the first woman admitted to study in the medical faculty of the University of Melbourne. She too, like Susan Lim, went on to forge a distinguished career as a surgeon and medical researcher. The election of Susan Lim as a fellow of the college recognizes not only her stellar work and her leadership in medicine, but also her commitment to community service, to charity, and to philanthropy. This institution has always encouraged students to pursue lives of service to wider communities, and many have done so in a multitude of different ways. One such person is our presiding bishop tonight, Dr. Peter Hollingworth, a former Trinity resident who has devoted his entire career to helping people in need, to promoting social justice, and to providing leadership in both church and public service, including as Archbishop of Brisbane and as Governor General of Australia. We So whether you have come for this special evening from Singapore, from even further afield as some have, or from close by, please know that you're most welcome. Tonight, on this Trinity Sunday, we worship God, the Holy Trinity, in this service, even as we honor one of the most remarkable citizens of Singapore and one of the outstanding members of this college, Dr. Susan Lin.
Amen. Thank you. When Jesus received their questions, he answered them. Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, stand up and walk? And so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the one who was paralyzed, I say to you, stand up.
Thank you. Thank you. As you know, eternal fellowship is the highest honor that the college can confer on anyone. And for me to be asked to give this address, time to confer on someone as distinguished as Susan Lynn, is a particular honor for me. I see in the program that I've been described as a preacher. I don't think I've ever been called a preacher before. I've given a lot of stress, but I've never been called a preacher. What I thought I'd do tonight, though, is talk a little about what Susan's presence and distinction means to Australia in relation to its approach to internationalisation of education. I'll then talk a bit more about Susan herself. I was going to describe in some detail her achievements because they're so stunning, but you'll see that they're outlined in the order of service. So instead I'll get much more annotated and interpreted version of my own viewpoint. But first, internationalisation. I think the referral today of the fellowship on Susan Lynn demonstrates again the enormous richness that comes from Trinity by its embrace of students from other countries. We often hear, and particularly in the media, that the number of students coming to Australia is in some way a detriment for education, that it impedes the access of students to our colleges and universities. And in fact, there's a shameful campaign currently being run by the Sydney Morning Herald along these lines. Nothing could be further from the truth. I think having the large numbers of international students has been an enormous asset to Australia. It adds to the richness of the experience of the students so that they gain intercultural understanding. But more importantly, it's also the next stage to Australia as a nation. I think all of us who travel through Southeast Asia are amazed by the number of people who come up to us and talk to Australia with great pride because they had their education here. And they continue to think warmly of Australia. This applies to people within business, people within the professions, even bureaucracy and politicians. I think it was very clearly demonstrated at the time that Dr. Mahathir was berating Australia and Australians, and Paul King was describing his recalcitrant. At that same time, trade, business, professional relationships, research and education would continue to proceed warmly because of the depth of the network that had been built. The same types of networks apply throughout Southeast Asia, and in future years will also apply to China. And with Monash's campus in South Africa, we hope in 30 years' time or so we'll have the same sort of network with all the countries of Africa because of students who have had their education in an Australian institution and spent some of their time in Australia, and at the same time some of the Australian students will benefit from studying in South Africa. We're living in a global world, and I think the experience that we can all get in that environment is enormous. quite remarkable is that instead then, having gone through that very extensive surgical training program, instead of going into surgical practice, high category surgical practice in Singapore, she chose instead to accept the Churchill Scholarship to go to study again in Cambridge as a doctoral student studying immunology and transplantation. I also, Susan, you won't know that that was a recipient of a Churchill Fellowship that had a formative effect on my career as well. While studying in Cambridge, she had won a number of awards and prizes, including a travelling scholarship to the US, where she studied pancreatic transplantation in Minneapolis. Again, a link to me, which is probably a little bit self-indulgent on such occasions, but back in 1973, I spent a period of 6 weeks going through the United States studying the very early stages of pancreatic transplantation. I decided a little too hard, and that was indeed reinforced when I spent some time in Sweden trying overnight to isolate islets from the human pancreas, which unlike the rats that have been studied in America is very much harder. It's been a holy grail of diabetes research because insulin treatment is far from satisfactory, as well as being very taxing, and the complications of diabetes remain crippling and life-shortening. But it's been a very hard road to follow, and after research in that area, Susan has moved on to stem cells, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a few moments. So having achieved complete training in surgery, as well as in research at a very rigorous level, PhD level, Susan did come back and was appointed as a senior lecturer at the National University of Singapore, and performed the first successful liver transplant in Asia. Again, enormous leadership in the field, and was appointed an associate professor at the age of 36, a remarkable performance considering the rigor of surgical training and the research for the PhD that followed that. I would like to just make a few comments about the role that Susan's played as a role model as a clinician scientist. Those of us in academic medicine recognise that one of our real challenges is to continue to entice bright young medical graduates into research. It's been a problem for many, many years, and in fact the most famous of clinicians, William Osler, 100 years ago, remarked on the difficulty of retaining bright young doctors who showed an interest in science. Research referred to the fact that soon the guinea stamp is on all their work. It's still a big problem, in fact, with the complexity of specialist training in medicine, it's harder still. But it's an absolutely essential role for people to be able to bridge the gulf between clinical medicine on the one hand and the study advances in basic science on the other. For the scientists to do relevant work on the one hand, and for that work to be applied in clinical medicine, requires people who have a foot in both camps, who are both Surely the Royal Ordinary that says that it may be is an outstanding addition to the ranks of fellows at Trinity College. It epitomises the energetic pursuit of knowledge, excellence, and dedication to community service, which are characteristics that Trinity College wishes to bring out. T.S. Eliot could have been referring specifically to Susan Lynn when he wrote, "Excellence encourages one about life generally. It shows the spiritual wealth of the world."
We do uphold the authority of the board and council of the college, so long as it is legally exercised, and do what is in your power to promote the good name and standing of the college.
I will.
Are you willing, so far as opportunity offers, to continue to support the life and work of the college?
I will.
Congregation, please. Almighty God, you have given us this college as a place of study and sound learning. Pour your blessing, we pray, upon Susan, now to be installed as a fellow. Grant that she may seek and learn truth, and in humility look to you, the source of all wisdom and understanding, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Members and friends of Trinity College, I present to you Dr. Susan Lim, duly recognized and installed as a fellow of this college. We pray for our students tonight.
the day you prepare for exams and assessment. This we pray through God the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God, the hero of all human tongues, we thank you that in this and every generation, you raise up amongst all people healers and visionaries. Here to be your very hands on earth. We give you thanks this night for Susan, for her talents and the care of human beings, her skills and visionary research, her academic pursuits, her life as a community problem, for her deepest philanthropy and generosity, for your good that we see in her life and work. We give you thanks for Susan and Deepak's company tonight, and that of their family and friends. This we pray through God the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Healing God, who knows that what we are made. We pray for all those who suffer at the hands of disease, that your new life may be breathed into all. We pray for the people in our local hospitals tonight, and all those who care for them. For the sacred ministry of surgeons everywhere, that they may understand themselves as the stewards of God's own creation. Pray this night for those known to us in need, especially those who hurt from the pain of illness or grief. We pray for Dorothy Markwell and her family as they keep vigil by their bedside. For Gary Young and his family. We give you thanks for Bishop Brown's recovery and his safe return home. This we pray through God the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. God, the Father, Son, and Spirit, in whose life we are given powers, we pray for those who have died, for all those who have in this short span of life, raise us up to be all that we can be. Give us grace to remember that we are part of us, and to treasure every day of our life, mindful that one day we too shall return to the dust of the earth and the ash of the stars. Help us to see in every day the strange things of God, in creation the bright spark of your spirit, and in all people the gentle face of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. We pray together the college prayer. Father,
through me,
Thank you.
on every side and guide you.